Hello everybody, Lucas Rousseau here. We are broadcasting from sunny Cambridge. I'm here with Lisel Alamilla, one of our plenary speakers. We've managed to persuade a few plenary speakers to join us at the Conservation Optimism Summit in April. And as part of that, we wanted to interview our speakers, talk about their careers, what they've achieved, and their hopes for the future of conservation and how to make it more optimistic in general. So welcome, Lisel. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
So Lisel, I'm just going to summarize your career. Correct me if I'm wrong at some point. So from what I've read, you did your master's in the States in conservation, then you worked as the director for Belize for one of the major NGOs based here in Cambridge, later became conservation director of the Yashte Conservation Trust, if I'm saying that correct?
It's Yashte Conservation Trust.
Yashte.
It's a Mayan word that means, it's a ceiba tree, very important in Mayan mythology.
Oh, okay. So the T is silent. Was that right?
Yes, Jay. I didn't know at that point that when it would be announced, I would have been invited to cabinet to be the Minister of Forestry, Fisheries and Sustainable Development. So when I received the award, I was Minister of Government.
Okay. So all that happened sort of quite quickly right after each other.
Right, yes. Okay. In fact, there was a debate at Whitley whether they would give someone from government the award. Okay. And then it was decided that, in fact, my work that they were awarding was something that I had been doing prior to my ministerial appointment.
Okay, so it all worked out then, I guess.
So
now you are... also need to pronounce this correctly, chair of the Toledo Maya Land Rights Commission. Is that right?
Yes, I'm the chair.
Okay. And what do you guys do at the commission? What are they all about?
Well, the commission was appointed by the government of Belize to implement what is termed as in legal language, a consent order. In regards to Maya land rights, an issue that has been bubbling and for many years, started more than 30 years ago, the whole movement towards the recognition of Maya customary land tenure in southern Belize. And in 2015, there was a consent order that was agreed upon by both parties. And after my tenure as minister, I was appointed to be the chair of the commission.
Okay.
So that's the work I've been doing since November 2015. Global objective is to develop the framework that would recognize Maya customary land tenure in southern Belize, in Toledo district in particular, which is the district that I reside in. And so it's doing whatever is necessary to ensure affirmative rights are recognized for the Maya people. It's a system that has existed for a long time, but there's no legal framework that recognizes it. So the goal is to develop a legal framework and a governance framework to recognize it. So to give assurances and to protect the rights of Maya people in regards to their land.
Okay, that sounds quite a complex task.
It's very complex. It's going to be very transformative,
yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah.
It's going to be touching on many areas. When you talk about land, you know, you talk about land affects so many aspects of people's lives. And so it is going to be very transformative when we at least set up the legislation. I don't believe that this work will ever end. It is something that will continue forever.
Yeah.
Because people will always be debating and discussing, and cultures and communities are always changing. So what is applicable today might not be applicable 50 years from now.
Yeah.
So whatever we develop has to be responsive to the possibilities that people will want change to happen. As these communities change because of more exposure to education, to access to other resources that they didn't have access to before.
Yeah. And I'm wondering if you guys have some sort of model that you're learning from, or if you're actually setting a precedent for the rest of these types of initiatives throughout Central and maybe South America as well.
We've been looking at various. We're looking at various models. We're looking at Australia a little bit. They have the Native Title Act. In Australia, they did a very specific act that looks at Aboriginal rights and land. And then we're also looking at the experiences in Canada, Belize, all these countries being Commonwealth countries. So the legal system is similar. But we're also looking at other countries and what they have done. And some of them have been doing it for a long time and where their initiatives have failed. And so trying to learn from those experiences. I don't think that there's a formula that fits everyone. You adopt it based on the history of each particular country. And so we're looking at that. For example, in some countries, the whole movement really marginalized the rights of women and impoverished them even further, indigenous women. So we are very much aware of that, and that is very much at the forefront of our thinking to ensure that we're not marginalizing women in regards to land and access to land, because if you take what is in existence now and you just put it into legislation, in many instances, when you look at customs, in fact, in many instances, are in breach of people's constitutional rights and human rights, right? And many of these societies, well, in Belize, they're patriarchal societies. And so that is something that we have to very much be cognizant of. And of course, we have to be cognizant of the young people, because in many instances, you have the tradition is that it would be older men who would be making decisions.
Yes.
But now you have younger men who are saying, hello, you know, I want to be a part of this decision making. I have gone to school, I am educated, and I see development differently than my father or grandfather. And then you have younger women who are saying, hello, you have excluded me for a long time, or you've excluded my mother, but you're not going to exclude me.
Right.
So it's balancing all these different changes. I mean, culture is not, it's not stagnant.
Yeah.
It's dynamic. So you have to respond to it. It would be very easy if we could put things in a little box and it doesn't change. And
yeah.
Then the solutions would be far easier, but
yeah.
That's not the reality.
It's not the reality, and it's always tricky with nature. You know, even if you work in reserves, you know, I think in the UK there's a tendency to sort of keep nature in a form of like arrested development often. And it's like we sort of forget sometimes that nature is dynamic and evolves. And I think especially when working with people like what you're doing, it's, you know, yes, it's politically complicated. It's socially complex. You're dealing with history, with culture, with different social norms. So yeah. Okay. So there's still a lot of work to be done by the sound of it.
This is just the first year. Well, we just completed the first year of our work, which was more information sharing.
Yeah.
And we did that in the entire district of Toledo. And so this second year, we're going to hopefully get into the more, I'm hoping to get into this discussion about what legislation would look like, what it should contain, looking, sorry, to discuss what the governance framework would be in regards to these lands. How do we ensure that we're responding to the things I spoke about earlier, about change and dynamic, communities are dynamic and all of that. How are we going to ensure that, in fact, we allow the Maya people to continue to be in a way that suits whatever is their aspirations. Of course, because of my background in conservation, people will look at this totally, or more specifically, at a human rights issue. But I don't see how you can separate issues of human rights with issues of conservation. Because, yes, you are advocating for land tenure, but you have to think about land that is going to continue to be productive.
Yes, and supply people with their basic needs, right? Yeah.
Exactly. So it's not only about ensuring that they their tenure is legally recognized, but trying to ensure that whatever is developed takes into account all that we have learned from conservation work, right?
Yeah.
Because Belize is not like other countries where you have, Belize is not a very large country.
Yeah.
And so the Mayas in southern Belize, there are a few villages where they're homogeneous and so forth, but they're not completely, they're not isolated from other ethnic groups. It's not like we have huge tracts of land where only Mayas live in, or like in Canada where you can give, I don't know, 500,000 acres to a group, because we are all mixed up, especially those communities that have opened up along highways and have opened up to other sectors, have moved away from subsistence farming.
Right, so are moving into what, more urban areas, pursuing different life choices than older generations, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, or even remaining in their villages, but working outside of their villages.
Okay.
Not doing farming, but still, you know.
Yes.
People have entered into the cash-based economy.
Yeah.
You know, so their needs have increased. So their demands for land have increased. They have moved, many are moving away from just subsistence farmer to looking at how they can make some money from it, to making it more commercial. Because, of course, now they aspire to more material wealth than was common before. I mean, women, for example, would tell you that if I can get a washing machine versus washing at the river, I would imagine that a lot of women would much prefer that. So.
Yes. Yeah. And you, it's a difficult want to argue with, right? But it, I mean, I guess all of these things have environmental implications, and it's probably going to be very difficult to balance that environmental cost with, the human rights issues, basic needs that people have and that aspire to, the things that we have, you know. That's quite tricky. I'm thinking in terms of, like, at the start of your career, when you first got into conservation, were you more interested in these sort of the more human component of environmentalism or conservation, or did you get into conservation because you fell in love with nature, or you experienced something as a young person that you thought, you know, this is what I want to dedicate my life to, or something like that? Or is it just a random sort of story?
It's a random sort of story. I never thought about conservation as a career.
Mm-hmm.
It just, a sequence of events landed me in the conservation field. But what I have always been passionate about is about justice.
Okay.
And for me, about fairness, and I guess once you start discussing that, again, it goes right back. When you're talking about people, then you start talking about the environment people live in, and there's no separation for me between a good life and the environment or sustainable development. And so that is kind of what interested me. The human component is what really attracted me. It wasn't the birds and the trees and anything. It's later on when I started reflecting about how come I'm passionate about this. Nowadays, people take their children to camps. They take their children on outings and discovery and these very organized forms of learning. And I never had that. But I was fortunate enough to grow up in very much connected to nature in the sense that I spent a lot of my childhood with my grandmother, who every day during the dry season took all her grandchildren to the river to swim because it was easier to take six of us there than to have all of us line up to take a bath and create a mess in her bathroom.
Yes.
And so not even thinking that you're spending 3-4 hours at the river every day just playing and exploring naturally and how that just became a part of what you do and who I am, and then having an opportunity later on to live in a remote area with my father who was managing a sawmill and having contact with people who were making a living from hunting, from farming, and just having what are now interestingly protected areas as my backyard. It wasn't a protected area at that point. In fact, that term wasn't even in existence at that time,
yes.
At least not for me. And so, you know, it's just having that connection to nature as constant.
Yes, and the exposure as a child. And yeah, because I guess if you spent a lot of your childhood, in that kind of environment, there was maybe some sort of subconscious attachment to wild spaces and the integrity of nature and, you know, its intactness. And because that's one of the things that a lot of people are talking about in the UK, it's this disconnectedness that people are increasingly having with nature. I mean, it's tricky to compare the UK with Belize because, you know, we have some of the lowest forest cover in Europe, but, you know, still people long for this connectedness. You know, people send their kids out to woods and, you know, there's all this increasing research connecting loneliness and depression with decreased exposure to nature. So it's interesting that, maybe having those experiences as a child do something to an individual as they sort of grow up, whether it's embed some sort of like environmental, passion or dedication to it, or, you know.
Because there are other people who grew up, in the same environment that I did, but they weren't really taken. They weren't allowed to engage with nature the way I was. I mean, after a rainstorm in Belize City at that point, when I was older, then you start going into, people be horrified, going into the drains.
Yes.
And trying, like tadpoles.
Yes. But probably the funnest thing for a child, really, right?
Going in there and collecting tadpoles, and that was just something that you did as kids, and there was no adult supervising
what
you're doing and explaining what the cycle of a tadpole is and what it becomes. It was just like, oh, what is this weird thing, you know?
Yes.
And
you just get to experience it, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So and I think sometimes it's just playing in nature. Unconsciously perhaps creates a love for it, having access to climbing trees, having access to doing things that you don't think are a big deal when you're raising a child, but when you're reflecting on it later, at least for me, I think about how privileged childhood I had.
Yeah.
You know, and so my father had all these illusions about, or I called him ideas about how he wanted to raise us. That was something he thought about farming. He was not a farmer. He was an accountant.
Okay. That's quite different.
Quite different. And, but he was very socially conscious.
Yes.
And my father grew up very poor.
Yeah.
And we had, but he provided us with a middle class upbringing. And I think he wanted us to appreciate what we were fortunate to have and to not let us feel that we were better than those who did not have the material wealth that we had. And so we grew up, when I was older, we grew up in the city of Belize, and I refer to that period as the time when we were the country bumpkins.
Okay.
Because father decided that we were going to raise a sheep, we were going to raise chickens, of course not legally. We had parrots, we had monkeys as pets, we had rabbits. It was this crazy world. And everyone really thought that we were kind of this interesting family.
Yes.
That so all the kids in the neighborhood then would be exposed to it, because my dad had provided this. Even up to today, I meet friends from my neighbor who remember when we slaughtered the sheep for a baptism, that event that we had, and they talk about how amazing that was to see. I mean, they would never have gotten to see that again. So I think all of these things kind of shape you. But I think what my father, especially, I refer more to my father, because in that aspect, he didn't really seek to educate us about the environment, as I spoke about earlier. But what he did seek in a very open manner is to ensure that we understood about fairness and justice.
Right.
And so my father was always very politically inclined.
Yes.
And so it was, my father used to take us to all his meetings. At that time, Belize used to have public meetings.
Yeah.
We didn't have radio or television used in the form for politics, partisan politics. So we would have to go, each neighborhood would have the person running for office going on the rostrum and speaking.
Yeah.
And so from a very young age, my father would take all of us to these meetings. Of course, at that point, we thought how horrible we have to stand here.
Yes. How boring it must have been for you as a child, right? But yeah.
But then realize that actually these ideas were seeping into my brain.
Yeah, because from what I gather, you were exposed to a lot of nature as a child. You were exposed to a lot of political activism as a child. And that's sort of what you've ended up doing, you know, built on from what your father, maybe those values that your father taught you, and sort of taken it one step further. So it's sort of like, so it sort of ties in with kids, right? Maybe, because a lot of these, I don't know if you guys did it at Yashte. But you know, a lot of conservation NGOs are keen to engage kids, not always knowing what the end goal will be, but sort of having this very well-intended idea of just exposing kids to nature. And it seems like sort of that's sort of what happened to you in a way. And here you are, you know, having worked as a minister, and you're now the chair of the Land Rights Commission. You know, maybe it's not exactly causally linked, but it seems definitely to have had a major influence in your life.
Definitely. And like I said, I never thought of a career in conservation. I didn't even know that existed when I was going to sixth form.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You became a doctor, a lawyer, an accountant, a secretary, a nurse, these kind of fields that you didn't, because you weren't really weren't exposed to these wide opportunities of careers.
Yes.
And so I just landed by chance. Somebody dropped out of a scholarship that they had.
Yeah.
And a friend who was in that scholarship program said, oh, I know someone who could take this up and could possibly do a master's in 3 semesters instead of 4.
Yeah.
And that's how I ended up having a master's.
Okay. So it all sort of...
resource creation.
Yeah. So
my bachelor's degree is in business administration. When they called me about that scholarship offer, I'm like, I'm not a biologist.
Yeah.
So I don't think I qualify for the scholarship.
Yeah.
Like, no. You know, it was a time when you're starting to recognize that conservation needs to be multidisciplinary. You have to have a multidisciplinary approach.
Yeah.
To dealing with conservation.
For sure.
And so having someone with a business background, having someone with whatever background,
yeah,
architecture, journalism, whatever,
yeah,
that everyone could play a role in the conservation field.
Yeah, definitely. And for sure, I think that is definitely still, they're still promoting that as... You know, at least I finished my master's a few years ago as well, and there were a lot of people doing career changes, you know, from accounting to marketing. And it was interesting just to meet all these people, you know, because if you do have a background in biology or zoology, you know, these guys just have completely different perspectives, and it always sort of challenges your own perspective, one that maybe tends to be dominated by the biology, which we know is not always relevant in conservation because it's a lot about people. So it's always interesting to find out about people's lives because they tend not to be sort of quite linear, you know.
Exactly.
It's different and dynamic and, yeah, quite interesting. But I guess in terms of your career, you have had some fun events, and I was very curious to ask you, because you read a lot about these types of events in the news, and to actually get to meet someone who's done it is quite rare. So I'm referring to this incident. So maybe you can explain it better, but what I read online is that illegal rosewood was intercepted by the authorities somewhere in Belize, and at the time you were Minister of the Environment, is that right? And you decided to burn the stockpile as to send a message, right?
Right.
Is that what happened?
That has a long history before it arrived at that point.
Okay, what happened? I'm very keen to find out.
That actually, the whole rosewood madness, I call it, was occurring when I was the executive director at Yashche.
Okay.
And it wasn't happening in the areas that Yashche was managing. So for a long time, we were seeing this happening and people were talking about it. And every time you drive up a few miles from out of town I live, you would see stacks and stacks of rosewood flitches.
Okay.
And it just, you know, it's in the media, people are talking about it. Being kind of like, okay, this is Yashche's area of work, this is our geographical remit, let's stay within our strategic plan. How is it impacting us? And so forth. And we decided that at that point, it wasn't something that was impacting Yashche's work. But then it just started getting crazier and crazier. And it was something that really consumed me when I was at Yashe.
Okay.
Just observing it, and we finally decided to start writing articles about it. Well, we had a botanist.
Yeah.
A woman that is in fact now studying at Oxford University doing her PhD.
Okay.
And she started gathering information on rosewood, and we started writing articles about it, and trying to create awareness about what was happening. And me personally, like, I sometimes imagine the worst case scenario. So in this case, conservation optimism wasn't in application.
Yes. A bit of realism was in need. Yeah.
Well, you know, I saw the madness. I understood what was driving these villagers to participate in the harvesting, illegal harvesting of rosewood. And I just imagined that they would finish the rosewood species and then they would move on to another tree. Yeah. Of value, and they would move on to another tree, and then we would not have no forests. And I had this worst case scenario.
Right.
Right, that we would. And then you read stories about what happens in other countries that overnight acres and acres of land are just cleared, all because of rosewood, trying to access rosewood. So I started talking about it on the radio, on the media, creating awareness, and I've never been, this has never been confirmed to me,
yeah.
But I have a suspicion that because I was so vocal about it, that when the Prime Minister was thinking about who to invite to sit in his cabinet,
yes,
that would have a conservation background, because it was the first time that anyone who had a conservation background was actively sought to sit in cabinet.
So that's quite cool.
That he thought of me, because I was, you know, I had been on the media because of rosewood, and I had been on the media because we were trying to put a stop to a dam that was going to be built in the Belize Nature Reserve, which was one of the protected areas that Yashe managed. And so I think he must have said, well, you know, let's see what she can do if I invite her to join my cabinet. And so I joined the cabinet, and one of the first things, he called me and said, so are you going to put a moratorium on rosewood? I was like, well, I thought, you know, now I'm no longer outside.
Yes.
I'm inside.
You could have had that power?
Yes, and I was like, I could do, well, I didn't know at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
He goes, are you going to put a, like day one, are you going to put a moratorium on rosewood? I go, can I do that?
Yeah.
Yes! And I'm like, okay. So that was
great.
Done in week one.
Yeah.
That was done in week one of my appointment, where we put a moratorium on the harvesting of rosewood.
Okay.
But we had so much material that had been cut.
Okay.
Already.
Yeah.
People had gone extremely mad. Cutting everywhere, just cutting every rosewood they could find. Not even knowing how they would take it out. People were taking it out on bicycles. People were just dragging it, pulling it,
So it sounds as though, so people were harvesting the wood without any buyers, without any demand for it, stockpiling it, or?
No, there were buyers.
There were buyers.
But,
okay.
Usually, of course, what you would do is that the people who are involved in logging are people who have logging concessions, you know. But now you have people who, especially in the south here, rosewood is a species that is used to build the traditional houses, because they last forever.
Okay.
They're long, and they use them as the beams for thatch houses.
Okay.
And so then they started. Well, they knew they had rosewood, and they started going into their forests and just cutting everything. It was complete madness. People were sleeping next to their rosewood trees that they had cut because they were stealing it from one another.
Wow. So
these are just subsistence farmers.
Yeah.
Who got involved in this madness because for them it was, they thought it was a lot of money they were earning. In the grand scheme of things, really they were not earning a lot of money. It was the middleman that was earning the money.
Okay. So was the demand internal then for these houses, or was it getting shipped out?
It was all sent to China.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's pretty standard then. Yeah.
The Chinese had representatives here in Belize buying it up.
Right. Okay. So you experienced this mania. You became the cabinet minister. You joined his cabinet, and then you decided to put a moratorium on the harvesting, and then burn the stockpile.
And then I started, of course, now everybody starts calling me, every truckload of timber they see being transported. Listen, I just saw a truckload of rosewood going by. So this one is involved in rosewood. Listen, do something about it, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm calling my forest officers, and I'm putting police checkpoints, and in the meantime, we're trying to be very systematic in trying to get the material that has already been cut, because, I mean, it'd be wasteful to take this material and just not allow it to be sold. It had been cut.
Yeah.
So had invested in it.
Yeah.
And it was poor communities. So we set a moratorium, and then a moratorium gave them enough time to say, okay, you need to declare to us all the material that you have.
Okay.
And then we're going to log it. And once you have that material, you can then sell it, and you can then export it if that's what you want to do, right?
Okay.
So take out everything that you have. But it couldn't be too long for them to cut more material.
Okay, yeah.
It just has to be enough time to allow them to take out what they had.
Right, okay.
So with the technicians at Forest Department deciding what amount of time they needed.
Yeah.
And so, anyway, it never stopped. We confiscated... We had confiscated a truckload of rosewood. It was sitting at Forest Department, one of the forest offices in the Toledo District. 100,000 board feet of rosewood, or even more. I don't recall. It was a huge amount. It was a truckload.
Yeah.
Then by morning, somebody stole it.
Wow.
How could you have? And then we had officers who were living right there.
Yeah, so.
And I'm thinking.
Yeah.
How could they move that amount of material and you're not carrying it during the night?
So is it.
And,
were there links to corrupt officials or.
Yes. Yes.
Absolutely. Yes.
And so it was, it kept going on. And then, of course, people are thinking that I'm going to come in and I'm going to fix it overnight.
Yeah.
And so it's not being fixed. They're starting to question whether you haven't now become a part of this circle.
Oh, really?
Well,
yeah.
Later on, they started suggesting that I had become a part of this cycle.
Wow, okay.
But this was, people weren't aware what all we were dealing with and what we were doing to try to stop the madness.
Right.
I guess one time they called me and they said we came upon this huge amount of rosewood that had been hidden in the forest, and that by this amount there should not have been any material that we did not have accounting for, right?
Yeah.
And there should not have been any material that we weren't aware of and where it was sitting and the amount. So when a village leader called me and said, you know, we were out and we came upon this huge amount of rosewood. And I debated what to do about it. Because at this point, really, I started seeing myself as Minister of Rosewood.
Yes.
And I had a huge portfolio that was beyond rosewood.
Right.
And so in talking to people, I can't disclose everything.
Sure, yeah. Absolutely.
I'll take all responsibility for the decision.
Yes.
I decided to burn it.
Okay. And do you think...
It was not a cabinet decision. It was not a decision done in consultation with any other elected official.
Okay. You know, I mean, I guess in that position, you must have been faced with limited options, you know. But I guess it's always interesting just to know whether you thought it, I don't know, maybe did send a message or, I don't know. Do you think it led to anything, even from a sort of legislative point of view, politically, or do you think it just frustrated people, you know, just from your perspective? It's interesting to, you know, explore this.
Well, so this thing was consuming me, right? And we were doing everything within what we could to contain it. It wasn't being contained. There were many, many, many people. I don't even know who all were involved, but not the moratorium, not anything that we were putting in place was working.
Yeah.
And it was just, one, I felt that they weren't taking me seriously as a minister.
Yeah.
One, because I was appointed senator and then invited to cabinet. I was not an elected official.
Yeah.
I'm a woman.
Yeah.
I come from an NGO background.
Yes.
And so, fairly young, you know.
Yeah.
In a very powerful ministry.
Yes.
And they kind of wanted to dismiss me, the powers, many powers that were in existence.
I see.
I was trying to communicate to them that, you know, this is unacceptable.
Yes.
And I just finally decided that they were not going to take me, they weren't taking me seriously, and I was going to show them who is the boss.
Yes, which is, I guess, sometimes what you need, right? I mean, you need to put your foot down and show your authority, I guess, and then...
So anyway, it was many factors.
Yeah.
I didn't think anyone was taking me seriously.
Yeah.
And I think that when I finally said, well, I take myself seriously.
Yes. Time for and, you to do it.
And so, you know, like you who have been exposed to people doing this with ivory, I too had been exposed to it, and it occurred to me that maybe this would achieve what I wanted.
Yeah.
And so I did it, and it did achieve. It did achieve a lot. I have absolutely no regrets.
Okay, that's good.
People flagged me a lot for it. Because people are like, why would she burn this? This is so valuable. Why couldn't she donate it to the schools? Yeah. Why couldn't she donate it to poor people? Why?
Yes. Did you also get a lot of flag or from the sector, from conservation people as well? Or was it more...
A lot of people from conservation sector.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay.
Yes, it was a lot of people from the conservation sector.
Okay.
But interestingly, in the people in the logging sector, they totally appreciated what I did.
Ah, interesting. So they got that sort of action that spoke to them.
Yes. The, you know, the the logging companies or the people who are involved in legal logging and have concessions and are involved in the very formal sector of logging. They very much, that was the group that really congratulated me and thanked me for doing it. Because there are other species that are also being threatened, not at this scale and not in a very in a public manner that rosewood was being done, but it's happening with other species.
Yeah.
So I feel like the Conservation Society had an opportunity to educate about what it is, because as in the position that I was in, I really couldn't get into the discussion. I did it.
Yes.
There, use it. In my view, use it as an opportunity.
Yes.
To continue the dialogue.
So I guess that can actually tie into this whole optimism thing, because maybe it was a missed opportunity. Maybe instead of attacking you and your decisions, there should have been a more optimistic, positive outlook, and tying into this whole change of perspective that we're trying to promote, you're trying to promote, the rest of the committee's trying to promote, this thing about not always being so negative about everything, recognizing real world difficulties and limitations and sort of, I don't know, shifting it to something more uplifting in a way.
Well, someone who has been involved in advocacy work in Belize for a long time told me that in their experience, that was the biggest act of activism had seen in Belize.
Okay, that's quite cool.
And the conservation community totally missed it.
Okay, that's a real shame.
Yes, they totally missed it. They missed it, they missed it.
Okay.
But they also missed a lot of things when I was minister.
Okay. So how do you think, because I think we should talk a bit about this whole philosophy, how do you think they should have, like, what do you think they could have done in that situation, in sort of in relation to optimism and selling a positive message?
Well, first of all, I think that there were a lot of, and I totally understand Joe Public not understanding what it is that I was doing, right?
Yeah.
Because, of course, it's valuable material. Of course, what they were saying was very legitimate, right?
Yeah.
But it opened the door for a conversation.
Yeah.
Saying, but yes, I agree with you, but listen, how about this? How about if this was a trend that continued? What would happen? You know, what if my nightmare, my fear became reality, which was like rosewood would totally disappear, then we would go to another species and another species. What about that? Like,
yeah.
Get more people to stop and reflect, you know? I mean, a girlfriend of mine who is an educator in one of the Mayan villages said to me that somehow, I don't recall how she said the conversation started about this. These are 10-year-olds. And they started this conversation about this woman that burned the rosewood. She's a crazy woman, right? I just love that 10-year-olds are having this conversation, right?
Yes.
And so she said she listened to them, and they were totally against what I had done. And so she said, okay, how about if I tell you why she did it?
Yeah. Because kids can be very... Right?
And so she said so she went through, because she had spoken to me, and she explained to them why it was that I did it. And after they were finished, after she was finished, she was like, Miss, I would have burnt it too.
Yes. Oh, kids are great, aren't they? When you
Yes. And so, oh. And they're like, how do you know that story?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
See, the story. This story, the rest of the story had not been told.
Right. It was just...
But the story was not to be, should not have been told by me.
Right. So it was, yeah, there was an emphasis on the negative when there could have been more emphasis on the opportunity that it could have, that it presented.
Yes, and people were focusing on all their people in high positions who are involved in this and corruption and all of that. And yes, that existed, but it was such an opportunity for dialogue about conservation in the Belize.
Yeah. And it
about looking at the forest sector.
Yeah.
And talking about it. It was just so many opportunities. Yasha did write an article, I think, Behind the Smoke.
Okay.
You know, that they I don't know, they published it somewhere, Behind the Smoke, right? Okay. But again, Yasha had to be careful because
yes.
That was where I worked before.
Yeah.
So they couldn't be seen to be totally just defending me.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, it's tricky, yeah. Isn't it? But I guess part of this, part of what we're going to try and do is to sort of make people think about these things and maybe be less reactive to sort of sensationalist headlines about wood burning or ivory burning. And before we pass judgment, maybe say, well, what's the good thing that came out of this in a way, you know? So I'm wondering, when you come over in April, what you're hoping to... I don't know if you have any hopes for this event or what you're going to talk about, just generally moving forward in a way.
I want to have a conversation.
Yes.
About it because when I wrote the little summary that I had to submit, I spoke about the role of organizations. And how do you get the individuals who work for the organizations to maintain optimism?
Right.
In light of the bombardment of the world, the sky is falling.
Yes. Okay.
How do you keep plugging away? You know.
Yeah.
Why don't we just give up?
Yes.
Every time you read something, it just tells you. Almost how impossible the task is.
Yeah.
And how do you ground yourself in this work? How do you continue to believe in it? Right? And I kind of shared my experience mostly at Yashe, how I believe in it and even when I was a minister, I couldn't make the changes and the reform I wanted. So I made sure that in the space where I could create change, how did I go about creating the change that I wanted? And how did I bring people in that were genuinely wanting to do what is right?
Right.
Instead of being dragged down by the people who didn't want to do what is right.
Yeah.
So being focused on that is so energy draining.
Right.
Right. And so there's so many aspects of this work. One is the individual that is involved in conservation. How does that individual remain positive? And how does that individual continue to the work 30 years later without becoming jaded.
Without being depressed, yeah.
Becoming jaded, just believing. And so to me, that is important, that the individual that works for these various organizations or these various movements, that collectively we understand the importance of that individual's well-being.
Yeah.
And not let people who have the opportunity that I have had to be left standing alone.
Yeah. So I guess I'm wondering if you think we have a peer-to-peer duty to support each other when one of us is feeling down, or whether, like, as what you were saying in your cabinet, you know, you were trying to bring these people in around you, whether it's more, whether it has to come from a leadership position where it's top down, permeates from top leadership, or whether everyone just sort of has to start, you know, uplifting each other and not always looking at the negative, or maybe both, usually.
Yeah, I think it's not let's be all kumbaya and the world is perfect.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, a bit of realism is healthy, right? Yeah.
Yes. It's not like, oh, you know, it is really it's seizing an opportunity.
Yeah.
Right? When you have someone that their learning curve doesn't need to be a huge steep in getting them to buy into the benefits and the importance of conservation, especially in regards to that when you're in government, right?
Yeah.
And so when you have someone like that, then you don't have to spend a lot of time. You don't have to spend any time really in convincing them about why the sea is important, why protection of species or sustainable logging is important. You have done, because we've had experiences where you've had people who are ministers of forestry and fisheries who have no understanding of knowledge about the importance of sustainable forest management. That's, right?
Okay.
So then you have to start educating them, inviting them, and hopefully they're open. If they're not open, then you have to find other strategies to try to influence them.
Yeah.
So sometimes it takes you 10 years to get that person to buy into it.
Right.
I mean, these are in many ways career politicians, right?
Right.
And so, fine, that's the nature of how it works. So it takes you 10 years, and then, well, in government, people are always changing.
Yeah.
Right? And so how do you take that opportunity of having someone who you don't have to convince, and how do you make the most of that person? How do you support that person? And I find you feel that in many conservation organizations are not dynamic enough to respond to that opportunity, because they're so focused on when you have to write a project and you have to get it funded and you have to...
It's quite slow. Yeah.
It's slow, right? And so, but maybe that's where the philanthropic organization, the private organizations can be more dynamic, more dynamic and responsive to the opportunity that is presented.
Yeah.
For example, right now we have a minister in Belize. He has a doctorate, and his area of work has been studying jaguars.
Oh, cool. Okay.
He's pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah. He has a doctorate in doing jaguar research.
Fantastic.
And I'm wondering, well, has anyone really approached him and said, here you are, the minister with responsibility for this, and how can we help you?
Yes. Because
you have to spend absolutely no time convincing him.
Yeah, that's
quite... about the importance of forest connectivity.
Yeah.
Right.
So.
So it would just be curious to know: are we going to sit and watch this man?
Yeah.
Who just maybe squander a golden opportunity?
Yeah. Well, because we often talk about the gap between what academics in conservation do, what we do as practitioners, and then the policy interventions we come up with. You know, often you hear people saying, well, if only we could get a hold of this politician and talk to them. And you're saying that they're ready. They're ready to hear our advice. Why aren't we doing it?
Why aren't we doing it? Why aren't we honing in? Why? It's like we have this kind of to-do list, and this is what we're doing. Fisheries, this, that. But, and then jaguar protection or protection of cats is number 10. So that's not what we're doing right now. Even though things, opportunity has presented itself where someone who is very much an expert in jaguar conservation has is a politician. Yeah. And why can't we just be more adaptive to that and saying, well, this golden opportunity has been, is being presented to us in Belize.
Yes. Let's capitalize.
And beyond that, Mesoamerica region.
Yes.
Because he has access and a platform from where to influence regional,
decisions.
Regional conservation work.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I guess. Yeah. I guess it's interesting. You know, I'm sure there are people in NGOs who would jump at an opportunity to speak with a politician. I guess how do we do that? But I guess we spend a lot of time talking about how to do things. Maybe we just need to be optimistic and go out and do it.
You know, a lot of organizations have came into my life, I call it, while I was a minister.
And then?
And have vanished.
Yeah, yeah. So it's about maintaining those relationships longer term.
They're not accessible. And somehow,
it's counterproductive, maybe.
They're missing an opportunity again.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm holding the position of the chair of the Toledo Land Rights Commission.
Yeah. So it's about...
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it doesn't mean that you have to give me any money for my work. It means that you should continue to try to nurture the relationship with someone that has a proven track record of being results-oriented.
Proven track record of that, but also proven commitment to it long-term, you know? Because a lot of conservationists move in and out, and change. You know, you're in it for Belize, so to say. So it's sort of, missed opportunity. But I guess, you know, reflecting on different attitudes between different generations, I think it's definitely changing. I know that a lot of people my age are definitely more positive. At times, you know, so
not because this is happening in London, because this is being organized in England, but my greatest cheerleaders I have found in the UK.
Oh, really? Fantastic.
You know, they really believe in me and have helped me up in many ways.
That's really
I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is in particular about these relationships that have been positive in that way for a long time now, more than 10 years.
Yeah.
To just, you know.
Maintain it.
Maintain it, yes. So to build, like you said, a long-lasting relationship.
Yeah.
With my, it's not like, okay, she's no longer a minister, she's no longer involved in cause, immediately involved in this little box, but have known that, in fact, when you stop and think about it, my work, a great part of my work at present, has such a great opportunity for application of conservation goals.
Yes.
Global. I'm talking to someone yesterday, how can we get funding for this work? Really, it's looking at climate change.
Mm. Yeah.
It's about conservation of species. It's about agriculture. It's about food productivity. It's all of these things that have to be considered.
Yeah. And I guess also maintaining those types of relationships, good relationships with people, also, you know, lowers the risk of failure, because you know, we often run into these issues where, you know, what you were just saying, you run out of money, or a funder changes their priorities, but having these positive relationships with people long term might mean that you can just continue that that long term conservation impact that you're working towards. So I guess it's definitely important to do that. Quite nice to hear that the Brits are still very supportive of the overseas work.
Yes, but not only like not only saying I support you, Lisel, but really in application I support you.
Yeah.
You know,
which not everyone does. So.
Yeah, and I agree. Maybe it's my generation, because it's my peers in my age group that's where I find a lot of support. But no, not really. Think about it. It's people in it's all the people in all older groups, age groups. I don't know what it is about that particular part of the world that has that approach to working. At least that's my experience. I think. Yeah. But I do believe that NGOs, the international NGO, need to self-examine.
Yeah. So hopefully we'll get a lot of them to attend the summit. We're working hard.
Yeah. One, they have to, the philanthropic organization, the private philanthropic organizations really need to examine whether they're getting returns. I call it returns on your investment.
Yes, I know what you mean. I've done research on capacity building with training, and I also was talking about this concept just to make things more accountable, almost, you know.
Are you getting returns on your investment? Like, are you? It becomes we from the NGO have created these great wonderful tools about measurements and impacts, but we're so caught up in that I think that we've kind of just disconnected from really understanding, looking at something beyond how it looks on paper.
Yeah.
And because we are sending out people to measure impacts who have no real on-the-ground experience, but might have all the academic training.
Yeah.
So it looks good. Yes, I can check it off my box. And yeah, they did this and this.
I know what you're getting at. Yeah. But like, hopefully, what we'll achieve here at the summit, you know, will be this dialogue. It will be a space for people to reflect on their attitudes, on what they've done in the past, on measuring impact, on supporting overseas people, you know, and hopefully we can all make a commitment to changing our perspectives and sort of, you know, and not just talking about it. You know, if we write an article, not just say how horrible the situation is, but maybe talk about how less horrible it is now compared to back in the 1980s or something like that. You know, I'm sure you can always find a perspective that's a little bit more positive.
For example, you're talking about, okay, here is a prime minister that made a decision to invite to his cabinet someone from the NGO.
Yes. Quite a big deal, actually. Yeah.
Quite a big deal. And nobody made a big deal out of it.
Yeah.
So, no one made a big deal out of it.
Yeah.
Not locally, not internationally. Nobody affirmed to him, because I don't know if he is even aware.
Yeah. Of the
that of how
significant or...
his decision was, right? And so versus somebody giving Belize and the leader of this country recognition.
Yes. Would have maybe helped him as well.
Yes. You know, to yes. say, well, wow, this is great. Maybe it's something that needs repeating.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? Absolutely, right. To make more of an effort to, yeah, acknowledge good behavior when, you know, or not good behavior, but, you know, give someone the recognition they need when they're doing the right thing and not just say, focus on the negative, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, listen, thank you for speaking to me. It's been a pleasure. And yes, I will see you in April.
Okay, Lucas. Good talking to you.
Yes. Thanks, Lisel. Speak to you soon.
Please edit this so I sound intelligent and all that.
Yes.
You have a good day or good evening.
Yes. Thank you. You too. Enjoy the rest of your day.
All right, Lucas.
Bye, Lisel. Bye-bye.